Roll call, please.
Mr. Perry?
Here.
Mr. Donahue?
Here.
Mr. Evans?
Here.
Mr. Gahn?
Here.
Mr. Rogan?
Please dispense with the reading of the minutes.
Third order, 3A, Single Tax Office City Funds Distributed Comparison Report 2017-2018, year-to-date November 30, 2018.
Are there any comments? If not, received and filed.
3B, Minutes of the Human Relations Commission Meeting held February 22, 2018.
Are there any comments? If not, received and filed.
3C, Tax Assessor's Report for hearing date held December 12, 2018.
Are there any comments? If not, received and filed.
3D, Minutes of the Civil Service Commission Meetings held September 6 and November 1, 2018.
Are there any comments? If not, received and filed.
3E, Minutes of the Scranton Municipal Recreation Authority Board Meeting held November 5, 2018.
Are there any comments? If not, received and filed.
3F, Agenda for the Board of Zoning Appeals Meeting held December 12, 2018.
Are there any comments? If not, received and filed.
3G, Minutes of the Lackawanna County Land Bank Meeting held November 9, 2018.
Are there any comments? If not, received and filed.
3H, Tax Assessor's Results Report for hearing date held December 12, 2018.
Are there any comments? If not, received and filed.
3I, check received in the amount of $1,000 from Covenant Presbyterian Church, which is payment in lieu of taxes for the city of Scranton.
Are there any comments? If not, received and filed.
3J, Controller's Report for month ending November 30, 2018.
Are there any comments? If not, received and filed.
3K, Minutes of the Scranton Firefighters Pension Commission Meeting held November 21, 2018.
Are there any comments? If not, received and filed.
3L, Minutes of the Non-Uniform Municipal Pension Board Meeting held November 21, 2018.
Are there any comments? If not, received and filed.
3M, Minutes of the Scranton Police Pension Commission Meeting held November 21, 2018.
Are there any comments? If not, received and filed.
3N, Minutes of the Composite Pension Board Meeting held November 21, 2018.
Are there any comments? If not, received and filed.
3O, Agenda for the Non-Uniform Municipal Pension Board Meeting held December 19, 2018.
Are there any comments? If not, received and filed.
3P, Minutes of the Quarterly Meetings of the Shade Tree Commission held April 18, 2018 and September 25, 2018.
Are there any comments? If not, received and filed.
3Q, check received in the amount of $200,000 from the University of Scranton, which is payment in lieu of taxes for the city of Scranton.
Are there any comments? If not, received and filed.
3R, Minutes of the Board of Directors Meeting of the Scranton Sewer Authority held October 25, 2018.
Are there any comments? If not, received and filed. Do any council members have any announcement at this time?
Yes, I have one. January 26th, the Friends of Shannon McDonough will be having the Polar Plunge. It's free to attend, $35 donation to plunge. You can register from 10 to 11 a.m. The plunge will take place from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. If you sign up to plunge by January 19th, you will receive a free hooded sweatshirt. This will be held at Montage Mountain. For more information, you can go to www.friendsofshannonmcdonough.com. All proceeds from this event benefit young individuals battling cancer in northeastern Pennsylvania. Thank you.
I have an announcement. City residents can begin placing their Christmas trees out at the curb. DPW will be picking up the trees at the curb when they see them, and our tree crew will be going into the neighborhoods to chip the trees on site. They should be picking them up until the end of January. There's also another option if residents prefer. Real trees may be dropped off at the County Recycling Center at 3400 Boulevard Ave, weekdays from 7 a.m. to 3:15 p.m. There's no charge to recycle the trees, but they must be stripped of all ornaments, lights, and tinsel prior to drop-off. The trees will be ground and turned into compost. And regarding tonight's agenda, a public hearing will be scheduled for next Monday, January 14th at 5:30 p.m. for item 5B, which is amending the Code of Ethics.
Fourth order, citizens' participation.
Our first speaker tonight is Lee Morgan.
Good evening, Council. Good evening, city residents. You know, with the new year about to begin, I think that I'd be hopeful that in the next council race, there needs to be a very thorough debate. And not only a thorough debate, but it's time for the citizens to come out and vote. There's just so many things to be discussed here. You know, the sale of the Scranton Sewer Authority. You know, I think the question that should be asked first is how much of the sales proceeds went into the city's pension plans? And where did the rest of the money go to? And I think it's time for the residents to let themselves be heard and ask for the FBI, the Auditor General, and the Attorney General to come in and honestly investigate the Scranton School District and Scranton City Government to try to figure out what happened to the parking garages and how they were transferred and how all those deals were structured. Because when you look at the city and you see children not receiving really any public education because the Scranton School District is mired in so much debt that the classrooms, in my opinion, have been stripped. And I'm just wondering, how can the residents of this city walk around in a trance for between 30 and 50 years and not realize that it's possible that their elected officials were looting their city? Because the Scranton Sewer Authority wasn't formed to pay the city's debts. And the authority, it was hired to protect that asset and to manage it, not to sell it. And when you look at a host of other issues in this city that have taken place over the course of the last 30 to 50 years, where has all the city's grant money gone to over all these decades? I think that's a very important question to ask. And who controlled it, how it was spent, and the city pensions. When were they last solvent? Were they ever solvent? And if they weren't, why weren't they? You know, we really need to ask a question of what does our city council, what function does it serve the residents of this city when the city is mired in blight from one end to the other? And when people are abandoning their assets and leaving, it's really a question that the residents of this city have to address. And they have to ask, does the government function to serve them, or do they serve their government? Because how much is enough of a tax burden to bear? Is it time to abolish the 2.4% wage tax that the residents pay this city? Because we have to ask ourselves, what is happening that is a positive development with that money? What's happening to all the money that's coming into this city? How much of the budget is actually funding debt? You know, another question to ask is, who is really running this city? And how were any of the latest decisions made about monetizing the sewer authority, shedding the parking garages, and a host of other things done to allegedly enhance the life of city residents? And I would like the people that are going to run for these council seats to address them, because at council meetings, we see a lot of suits and a lot of silliness, but we don't really receive any answers. And right to knows? Why should residents have to do a right to know what's occurring in their city government? Every single thing this city does should be on the city's webpage. Every single thing. And to have a councilman say at a public meeting that this is going to be recorded into the public record, there is no public record here. And when Mayor Connors was here talking about pancreatic cancer, and the council president said that, that would lead people to ask one question. Is their government competent? And why isn't there a public record of the things that are taking place in this government? The other question that city residents need to ask is, what vital function does the mayor perform? And what does he do on a day-to-day basis? What is his schedule and his job duties? What does he actually do for the residents? It's time to start asking questions, but more than that, it's time to get some answers.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Mr. Bolas.
Evening, Council. Bob Bolas, Scranton. Sorry not to see Pat Rogan here tonight, but I do want to personally thank him that when I wasn't at the last meeting, he mentioned about the Christmas dinner that I hold, and this was the 25th year we're doing it. Because of his comments made, people came up to me at the dinner and said they didn't even know about the dinner until they saw City Council and heard Pat Rogan speak about it. So I want to give him a personal thanks for taking the affirmative and going ahead and announcing the dinner, because it was an important dinner to a lot of people. I hold it on Christmas Day, and I've held it for the last 25 years. And this year was the best we ever had. We had thousands of people that showed up. We delivered over 600 meals, not only in Lackawanna County, but all the surrounding counties. And that's the importance of who we are in Scranton and in this county. You know, on Christmas Day, I put all my differences to the side with anybody and everyone. And people came there because they know it was an open place to enjoy and not be in competition or argue with anybody or anything else. And I want to thank St. Pat's Church for allowing us to be able to use the hall there. And naturally to all the volunteers and, of course, to the people who actually showed up there and enjoyed the dinner. And hopefully next year will even be better than it was this year. That's one thing I intend to continue, whether I'm in the area or I'm out of here, that dinner will continue. And maybe more people will take the lead and do other things in other counties to take care of the people who don't want to be home alone on Christmas. It was just a great day. We had a Santa Claus. We had kids getting gifts. I couldn't think of anywhere else in the world I would rather be than there on Christmas Day. I want to get into some of the things here. We got to take issue with the school board. They're running rampant. They're out of control. They're basically thumbing their nose at each and every one of us. And I think council's got to take an active role in going to these meetings. So I didn't like to see our meetings on Monday night because it kind of stops us from going to a school board meeting if we come here. And they got to be held accountable. I've been to the school board meetings, and they could care less what you have to say. They're doing what they want to do. They're killing our city. They're killing the growth that we want to have here to pay for what? Now, corporations and companies make cuts to survive, and they got to do the same thing. And quit playing the game. They only work 180 some days out of the year. Try working 365 days and come out in all kind of weather, like our police and our fire, our DPW, and everybody else that goes to work. They can't stay home and get a paycheck. So we got to start drawing in all the negatives in the area to put us back in a plus column. Put us back what Scranton used to be. And get rid of this nonsense. You know, we had the parking spaces at the mall that I've raised this issue many times. We paid millions of dollars for those spaces. But nobody even knows where they are. You get a ticket to go in there. You can only park just for a short period of time. And we gave this guy millions of dollars. We won't do anything, and that's why I've asked council to go to the school board and ask the school board to push for a reassessment of the mall. get our fair, just money back here. If we want the city to grow, we got to make everybody pay. I mean, I'm going through a tax issue. The Times likes to keep writing about the taxes that were illegally put on me. And I had a fight in the court system to do it, and it distracted from the companies I'm running that impeded our ability to go forward. And that's why I liquidated what I've done, because they don't deserve our company here. They don't deserve what we could give here. And they get away with what they're doing. The tax office, Kolodziejski, Joyce, who wears two hats, he's the solicitor and the tax collector. That's the stench that comes out of the city of what's going on here, where they could put a personal judgment on somebody for taxes that should just go with the land. These are the issues we got to deal with. These are the things, if you want to see growth happen here. We got to drain this swamp, not worry about Washington. We got to drain the swamp we got right here. And it's up to you guys to take the affirmative with the school board, with the mall. Get the money we got coming. And let's get on a positive note here and move forward. I don't need to come in here and talk about where I'm at. I know where I'm at. And our auction was tremendously successful, and we're going to have a couple more yet. But people knew the equipment and knew what we have to sell, and they came from all over the country to buy it. That's the credibility we built, and everybody wants to be negative about it. I've been an employer for 57 years in this community. How many people could stand up and say they've done the same? This is still my town. No matter what part of the world I'm in, Scranton is still going to be my home, and I'm still going to come here and fight for it one way or the other. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Bowles. Our next speaker is Mr. Ellman.
Yes, Council, I wish to thank Mr. Bowles and all his many volunteers that so unselfishly gave their time Christmas Day, of all things, and decorated that hall so nicely. And this is a showing that there's so many volunteers out there that can do things for this city that aren't called on. You never make me believe that Mr. Volpe and all the people have to go to New York City to show off with all the fine restaurants here. That's I'd be ashamed to admit I was doing something that foolish myself. One of the best restaurants I ever found in New York City, and I had someone in the movie business. He was used to find locations. He took me to a place on 8th Street called Smith's, like homemade food. You don't need to show off like he does, Mr. Volpe does. And now, about this building needing all these repairs. I know you don't want to hear it again, but you remember last year, I stood here and others did about that $3 million you so foolishly threw away. Now we could use it on our own building instead of this vile institution using it on buildings that aren't even on the tax rolls. Why don't one of you go ask him to give us the money back? Yeah. I'd like to see that. You know what they told Mrs. Evans? Go to hell and take your bunch with you. They'd do the same thing. That's the caliber of people they are, if you ask me. And you shouldn't do business with people you can't trust. You sure can't trust that place. And lastly, I know you're waiting for that. I saw where Mr. Pachecki, I know I don't know how to say it, was given a couple years probation and had to repay, I think, $4,500 or something to three people for practicing law without a license. Well, right here, I've said it, Henry Hermosa practiced law without a license on the sewer authority with his law firm. He's not licensed in the state of Pennsylvania. Why isn't something being done about him? He got over 10 times as much as $4,500. You know, I think Scranton just must be the capital of corruption in the whole country. That's not right when an employee of Lackawanna College can get away with something so serious and nobody wants to comment on it or do something about it. Everybody's deliberately avoiding this situation, and it's going to backfire on you. I filed a complaint with the Attorney General, like I told you, and they sent me a letter that I was in the wrong department, and they sent me who to send my complaints to. I know I'm going to get you guys mad right now, but I think it's past time that council got out from under the mayor's thumb and do their job. So far, you've been a bunch of yes men all year, and the city hasn't benefited from this council any. It's working the other way around. It's like the last meeting, I told you about 4, 5, 6 adversities in my neighborhood. Nothing's done, they're all there, except the junkyard on Troop Street's gotten worse. He had 7 junk cars there yesterday. Well, they all weren't junk. He got 2 on the street, been there for, God, I don't know, pushing a year. The car on Main Street by my house, been there for 5 years, sitting on the sidewalk. Isn't it time to, we got this licensing bureau, they don't seem to care. I don't know what you do when you complain about something. Thank you anyway.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Joan Honowanitz.
Joan Honowanitz, city resident and taxpayer. What is the current status of the Arcadis study?
Nothing new that I can report.
Okay, now you know I'm the soul of patience. But this sucker is now 15 months late. Okay, there were 2 articles in 2 different local newspapers over the last few weeks which directly impact on this whole problem. One was in the Times Tribune on December 23rd. It was on climate change in northeastern Pennsylvania. The bottom line was we had a record year of rain in 2018, and that's going to be the new normal. So stormwater is going to take on added significance, and it's going to be harder to do with all that rain coming down. The second one was in the Times Leader on January 4th, and it was a story about the Wyoming Valley Sanitation Authority and its efforts at stormwater management. Now, they had problems. They were sending out bills, and there was a mess, and they were getting a lot of complaints and a lot of questions because people did not understand what was going on. But on the positive side, at least Wyoming Valley Sanitation Authority is doing something. We are so far behind the power curve on this issue. It's pathetic, okay? And we can't even get a status on where we're going to get the results of the Arcadis study. And we aren't even sure what that's going to tell us. I mean, how are you going to determine each resident's impervious assessment? You know, how are you going to, you know, structure the fee schedule? How are you going to handle builds? You know what fun we have with the refuse builds in Scranton. You can't keep pushing this can down the road, and eventually it's going to backfire big time. But hopefully next week you'll be able to tell us something about when are we going to get the results. Somebody running that 15 months late and they won't give you a status of when they're going to wrap it up. This is worse than the Mueller investigation. Okay, enough about that. Last time I looked on the website, I did not find the 2019 operating budget. Will somebody please kick the can on that one? And also, how about the most recent capital budget? That should be on the website, too. Lori, I gave Kathy a copy of the tax assessor's final report for December 12th. When I looked on your website, the last column was illegible. So I went to the tax assessor's office and got them to give me a paper copy in case anybody should ask you about it. Your draft code of ethics, I did sit down and read it. First of all, kudos for doing it. It's long overdue. I do have some questions. First of all, why don't you send a courtesy copy to the Scranton School District? Yeah, they need all the help they can get. Hopefully you'll have your own web page or something on the website, and hopefully someone other than IT will make sure that it's kept up to date. On the budget for this entity, you mentioned in the caucus that it'd be coming out of professional services, which makes sense. But you haven't got any idea how much this is going to cost?
Well, I think it would be based on the complaints that come in.
Well, you still aren't you going to have to retain attorneys and solicitors and retaining fee?
The way that the legislation is written, the board will have to retain a solicitor. Mm-hmm. They're only required to meet once a year to elect a chairperson and a vice chairperson.
Yeah, I understand that.
Right. So then they'll only have to meet, according to the legislation, if they get a complaint or if they have to review the
report.
Gifts,
forms.
Right.
Okay, I understand that, but I'm just trying to get a handle on, you know, what is the minimum that has to be budgeted for it on an annual basis, and obviously there'll be no cap.
Yeah, I understand that it might be difficult to try to estimate that only because this is a totally new venture. So
recommendation, like the county, you need a whistleblower hotline. Talk to Gary DiBilio. The county has saved quite a bit of money over the years with their hotline. You need to do the same.
That is a good recommendation. The board, as it will be constituted once this legislation is passed, there is a lengthy paragraph about whistleblowing in there. Now, if you
I didn't see a hotline though.
No hotline, but they have a procedure in there where they can submit a formal complaint to the board, but it has to be confidential.
I would still like to see a hotline.
A hotline, sure.
I think that's a good thing.
Mm-hmm.
I'll get the rest next week.
Thank you. That's all the names on the sign-in sheet. Is there anybody else who would like to address council tonight?
Marie Schumacher. 5 weeks ago when you last met, I stated that I thought it was time that we revise the Home Rule Charter and review it. I think there's some constructive changes that could be made to it. Mr. Evans, you said that it's about time, so hopefully in 2019 we could have that conversation.
Absolutely.
I hope that you get that started this month because it's desperately needed. I mean, I even wonder, maybe the solicitor would know, the fact that any work that's been done under the capital budget from last year, which you never even brought here, if that was even legal, it could be challenged. But moving on, one thing for the general public. There is a gentleman who called me up months ago and he needed some typing done and I was swamped, and I'm not exactly unswamped now, but I could help him if he wants to call me back again. I misplaced his telephone number, so if he'd call me. Also at the last meeting, it was rather disturbing because a resident of the area down by the Keystone on Olive Street came in, and I mean, I empathize with them. Nobody wants to find needles and people who have overdosed. But why? I'm bothered by the fact that we're going after the mission and blaming it on the mission, who's trying to help them. And then I thought, well, you know, okay, so if you do something there, all you're going to do is chase them someplace else. And even right now, I think there's a group forming, I think it's part of Naog Park that isn't used on the opposite side of 81. It's growing. There's a bunch of tents there, and I'm pretty sure it's not Boy Scouts, so I'm guessing it's a homeless community that's there. So I would like to know what our policy is. Around the holidays, I noticed there were organizations that were putting packages together for the people, toiletries, and for the homeless people, and going out and delivering them, and they were talking like 500 packages. Now, do we even know what our homeless population is, and what's our policy for treating them? I mean, you can change them, make them go from neighborhood to neighborhood, I guess, but I don't know that that's a good thing for anybody. So I would like to know what our policy is. Do you know? Or how many, what the population is estimated to be?
I don't know. I don't know that the city actually has a specific policy. I've never seen one, but I would imagine, I would assume that the police department has a way to handle the homeless population if they come upon, like you said, the tents. But I will definitely look into that. I don't know that there is one.
Well, I definitely think we need one. And then that sort of leads in, because of course some of it's opioids, and what is our policy with the drugs? When, and again, Knox, I don't, that thing, they,
Naxalone, Naxalone.
Not what, however you pronounce it, yeah. When that's given, do we have a policy? For instance, if a police officer, anybody in the city. Has to use that? Is do we have a record of how many times that's been used by a police officer or a fire officer or anybody in an official capacity? And then who's in charge of a follow-up? Does anybody go back and say, okay, you know, we saved your life. Who sold you those drugs? Where did you buy them? Do you need help if you're addicted? What is our policy?
Off the top of my head, I don't know. Mr. Perry is public safety chairperson.
True.
Could probably meet with the chief and find
out. I know
there's.
I know both police and fire have training on administering it. As far as what their policy is on follow up and who, you know, there is a recording record of when it was administered, but I don't know how that information flows per office. But I know there is. And as far as the follow up, I'm just unaware of it. I'd have to ask.
Well, obviously, if there's a death, there's a criminal investigation after the, you know, of course, there would be. If there's an overdose or something like that, there would be a criminal investigation. But we could certainly talk to the chief. I think he has some programs in place that he uses all the time. And I know that there was a grant not too long ago that was specifically for that purpose.
I'd like to see it. I mean, there must be a hard copy if there's a policy. I would like to see that and how many.
Absolutely.
Okay. I will, good Lord willing, I'll return next week with finish. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anybody else who'd like to speak with council tonight?
Fifth order, 5A motions.
Mr. Donahue, any motions or comments tonight?
Just one quick comment. I'd just like to first wish everyone a happy and healthy new year. We have a lot that we're going to have to get done this year, and I'm hopeful that this council, along with the administration, will be able to work together for the betterment of the citizens that we represent. And I think that's all I have for tonight. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Evans, any motions or comments tonight?
Yes, I do. First of all, I'd like to take a moment to acknowledge the passing of Dr. Peter Couple. I had the pleasure of serving with Dr. Couple on the board of the Architectural Heritage Association and the Historic Architectural Review Board of the HARB. Peter was a tireless advocate for the arts and a champion to the cause of historic preservation his entire life. He was a gentleman, a true Renaissance man, and a great friend. And he will be missed by every person that ever crossed his path. So rest in peace, Peter. Since this is our first meeting of 2019, I find it only fitting that our first legislative act for the new year will be to introduce an amended ethics guidelines for the city of Scranton. In doing so, we are rushing in a new era of transparency and trust. The public deserves no less than their government, and I'm extremely proud to be part of the City Council that has taken the lead on this issue. I would also like to thank Councilman Gaughan for championing the effort. While the new code is extremely comprehensive, I am particularly excited that it will include campaign finance reform. I cannot stress how important and groundbreaking this is for Northeastern Pennsylvania's largest city. This is not only will help level the playing field in many ways, but it will attempt to minimize the impact of infusions of large amounts of money that may have influenced elections in the past and will in the future. Hopefully it will not. Also, in the last 4+ years that I have been a member of City Council, I can point to many positive achievements that have happened for the city because of the dedication of the gentleman sitting to my right, as well as Bob McGough and Joe Wexler. But 2019 has the opportunity to be the most significant year ever in terms of creating lasting positive change. Change that in some ways may have short-term effects, but more likely will have long-term effects that will be seen for years and years to come. But none of it will happen without a renewed commitment from those that are charged with making that positive change happen. Tonight, I'm reinforcing my commitment to make those changes a reality. Excuse me. This year, changes like seeing the implementation of C-Click Fix and the Smart Cities Kiosk program, changes like a downtown mobility study that will focus on our city's walkability, as well as the implementation of many of the great ideas that I'm sure will come out of that study, a new zoning code, blight reduction recommendations, including a revamping of the quality of life ticket program, the removal and reduction of dozens or more fees and fines, as well as a revised condemnation and demolition policy. Additionally, we will need to make changes to policies that will create a more business-friendly climate in every department in the city. The elimination of the unfair and draconian mercantile and business privilege tax and its replacement with a broader, fairer payroll tax. An expanded historic district for the downtown. The continuation and additional funding for the SHAP program, which is a successful program that we developed for first-time homebuyers. The development of a companion program, which will be called the Beautiful Block Grant Program, to be announced shortly, which will be funded in part by nonprofits, foundations, and others. The implementation of a permanent and comprehensive stormwater management strategy. The continuation, of course, of the idea sessions, the implementation of an internship program in our City Council office, and what I view as very important, the expanded use of City Council work sessions to move along these and other initiatives that my council colleagues would like to champion. We need to root out and implement innovation at every opportunity. As I have stated before, innovation is only creative ideas that are completed. 2019 will be about getting ideas completed. We have an opportunity this year to change our city forever, and we can only do it together. So my promise is that I will work as hard as I can to make those changes and others that we may not even know about yet all occur in 2019. I plan on doing all of that with continuing civility, working with others, and with a clear vision. And finally, I promise that I've done for the last 4+ years to make those decisions without the need to view results through a political prism, but in the context of what is right for the city of Scranton. So I ask my colleagues, all of whom have shown great support for many of the initiatives that were mentioned earlier, and members of the administration and the public, to join in this renewed commitment for 2019. And let's make this year when real positive change happens and the great ideas are finally completed. And that's all I have for tonight.
Thank you. Mr. Gaughan, any motions or comments?
Yes, thank you. First, I'd just like to ask if we can send correspondence to the administration for an update on the Sorrenti Center project. The city acquired the Sorrenti Center up in the Hill section, and I would like a breakdown of how much money the city has spent to date and what grants we've been approved for. When the city acquired the Sorrenti building, I was against that for a number of different reasons. Number one being that I thought it would cost a significant amount of money. Number one, to maintain the building and to improve it. One of the reasons that the administration used, from what I can remember, in saying that the city needed to acquire the building was they needed more storage. And if they did not acquire the Sorrenti Center building, they would need to build a pole barn structure on the site of the Scranton Police Department headquarters. So in the 2019 budget, it says that the city will be spending money to construct a pole barn in the parking area for storage. Again, I was under the assumption that this expenditure would not have to take place if the city acquired the Sorrenti Center. So if we can get an explanation on that, I'd appreciate it. I'd also like to send correspondence to Mayor Courtright and the superintendent of the Scranton School District on what steps both administrations have taken or will take with regard to the recommendations and suggestions from the Shared Services Committee. In December, Councilman Donahue and I had presented, along with members of the Scranton School Board, a list of recommendations, kind of a guideline on things that we found where the city and the school district could work together to share services, to become more efficient, and to possibly save money. So I do think we need an update on that so we do not let that conversation die out. So if we could send that, I'd appreciate it. Also, I did meet with Representative Julie Schumacher-Cohen from the University of Scranton about the internship program between the university and our office. It was a really great conversation that we had. I would like to get this underway by the end of the month, in the beginning of February at the latest. I have spoken to Mrs. Reed about it. There is a template that we are going to use that the mayor's office currently uses for interns that they try to get from the university. So we're going to use that as a guideline, and we will continue to have conversations about that. But I think moving forward, that's a really positive step for the city and for City Council's office. The other part of that, and Councilman Evans and I and Councilman Donahue, Perry, and Rogan often talk about the city's lack of presence on social media, whether it be Facebook or Twitter, Instagram, whatever. It seems to me that there are a lot of people that use social media anymore. So I do think that it would be beneficial for the city to have a presence on social media, whether it's pushing out notifications or updates to projects going on in the city, leaf collection, when they're picking up garbage and recycling, different things like that. And I think we can tie that into our potential internship program with the University of Scranton. So that's the conversations that are ongoing. In December, I spoke about bringing the American Lung Association in to discuss requiring more signage where tobacco is sold within the city and looking at possibly banning establishments from selling tobacco within 1,000 feet of schools within the city. I also would like to discuss the vaping epidemic and what we might be able to do legislatively to curb that. So I will ask my colleagues if we can schedule that meeting with the American Lung Association over the next few weeks. Mrs. Schumacher brought up tonight 2 points. Number one, the homeless population and what the city's policy is or the police department's policy, and the opioid crisis. I think at this point we should probably invite, if my colleagues would agree, Chief Graziano in to discuss both of these topics, especially the opioid crisis. We have had, as has been pointed out in the newspaper, multiple tragic overdoses over the last month. What we can do legislatively, I'm not sure, but I do think that we should get an update from the chief and see what direction our department and our city's moving in combating that. Also, Mrs. Reed, if you could just send a reminder to the administration to see if they can put the 2019 budget on the website and an update on the capital budget, as was mentioned as well. And that's all I have. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Gohan. Just a couple things from tonight's meeting. Mrs. Reed, if we could send something to Mr. Balzoni and Mayor Courtright about the Arcata study. In light that everything's happened in Luzerne County in the last couple days, it just puts a new emphasis on what we're going to be dealing with. And I think we all are definitely in the know and should be in the know and deserve to be in the know of what's happening and where we stand in this process. It's been a while since we had any kind of update on the status of it. So if we can get a status on when we should receive something, and even if it's not a final living document, is there anything they can share with us that we could explain or leak out to the public? Because this isn't going away, and that boulder's only getting closer. And echoing what Mr. Gaughan said about Ms. Schumacher's comment, I think that's an excellent idea to get Chief Graziano in here on both issues. The homeless issue that we have isn't by nowhere near the epidemic that is in some areas, but that doesn't mean we don't have one. And that doesn't mean that what we have, we can't do better. So it's a good starting point to know where we're at and what we actually do about it currently. And the opioid epidemic, you know, I was one of the first people on the record to say this years ago about how that devastates not only families, but communities and our entire area. And, you know, any life we can save is worth all the effort that we can put into it, because it's an awful situation. While we're waiting for Chief Graziano to free up a chunk of time to come and meet with us, if it's not too much to ask of him, could he send us the policy that he currently has and enforces with the Scranton Police Department for caring for and managing our homeless population in the city, as well as the policy for administering Narcan, kind of centered around the training, how we log it once it's been used, and do we have any kind of follow-up system in place for the recipients? Thank you. Other than that, I just want to say Happy New Year to everybody and hope everybody had a happy and healthy holiday season. And thank you.
5B for introduction and ordinance, amending the Code of Ethics of the Administrative Code of the City of Scranton, Pennsylvania.
At this time, I'll entertain a motion that item 5B be introduced into the proper committee.
So moved.
Second.
On the question?
Yes, on the question. I am extremely pleased tonight to be able to vote on this legislation to completely revamp the City of Scranton's Code of Ethics for several reasons. First, I think it's extremely important for the residents of our city to have confidence in the integrity of their government. Every single Scrantonian has a right to expect that all city officials are independent and are fair towards every single resident, and they do not favor a small group of individuals or themselves. A strong code of ethics creates a standard of professionalism in the city. This type of professionalism and transparency should build trust within the community. With several investigations by the Attorney General and Auditor General taking place within our community over the last few months and last few years, it's really caused a black eye for our area. And I think that it's important that the City of Scranton set a standard that we will not allow and we will not tolerate any type of corruption. I think that this code of ethics should constantly, even after we adopt it, hopefully within the next 2 weeks, be taken off of the shelf, dusted off, and revisit it constantly to make sure that it remains up to date. One of the issues, and I brought this up a year or two ago with the current Board of Ethics, is that it basically has been non-existent and dormant. Every single board member's term had expired, yet none were reappointed and no new members were appointed, even after I had alerted the mayor and the administration. This legislation, it's my belief, gives the Ethics Board teeth and the tools to do their job, clear guidelines on how the board should conduct their business. There's a few things that I want to highlight. Now, this code of ethics is 29 pages, so I'm not going to go through every single thing. It is available on the city's website, on council's page, if you wanted to view it. But just a few things I want to touch on. Number one, the composition of the board. This will be changed if this legislation passes. In the past, the mayor would have all five appointments to the Board of Ethics. Under this legislation, council will have two appointments, the mayor will have two, and the city controller will have one. I thought that was fair, and I have to give credit to Councilman Evans with that idea. I originally wanted council to have all five appointments just for the check and balance effect of the legislative branch on the executive, but I do think that that was a fair compromise. Also, within the legislation, there are strict rules about city employees and city officials receiving gifts and solicitations or acceptance of gifts. No city official or employee or member of his or her immediate family shall accept or solicit any gift, gratuity, money, favors, invitations, food, drink, loans, promises, or other benefits from any person, firm, corporation, or association which, to his knowledge, is interested directly or indirectly in any manner whatsoever in business dealings with the city, provided that city official or employee has any influence directly or indirectly in any manner whatsoever in the city's participation in those business dealings. There are several exceptions. I won't go through every single one of them. There is a case if you do accept a gift and it's not minimal, anything under $50, you do have to report that to the Board of Ethics, and then they will meet and determine if you have to give the gift back. So again, there are several. There's a very lengthy process that is delineated within this Code of Ethics. Also, this was in the last Code of Ethics, but I think it's important to point out. We do have a nepotism policy. Hiring a relative is a special type of conflict of interest that should be avoided. No public official or employee shall appoint, hire, advance, or advocate the appointing, hiring, or advancing of a member of his or her family, his or her immediate family, or household member to a city position. I think that's important that remains in the updated Code of Ethics. Also, whistleblowing. Mrs. Hodowanitz brought that up tonight. Employees are expected to expose any violation of this Code of Ethics by any employee or business entity, and they should not expect to be reprimanded in any way or threatened in any way. So that is also delineated in our Code of Ethics. There's quite a few other things in here about fraudulent or other activity, use of city property and personnel, political activities. There's lengthy information about contracts, the awarding of contracts, and then there are specific recommendations to the mayor on what happens if you violate the Code of Ethics. One thing we talked about in the caucus that I think is really important, this board will be required to meet every January and elect a chairperson and a vice chairperson. In the past, I don't think it was required that the board meet, and therefore they became kind of ineffective and dormant. This board will have to meet, and they will be able to give city employees or city officials advisory opinions. And what that means is, if for any reason you think something is going to be unethical or may look unethical, then you should ask for an advisory opinion and get an official opinion from the board so that you can avoid that whole process. There is a section about how you can make a complaint and the investigation procedure that will take place then after that. I also want to point out, I think this is very important, that there is a section on here about the confidentiality of the complaint and the wrongful use of the Board of Ethics. I don't think anyone on this council was eager to, you know, redo the Code of Ethics so that there would be fraudulent complaints. In other words, you cannot use this board to harass a city employee just because you don't like them or for any political reason. Again, if you look at this document, it is very, very specific. The complaint process is extremely specific. So in case anybody was wondering about that. And finally, and what I think is probably most important, is the campaign contributions and reporting requirements. Under this Code of Ethics, there will be a limitation on how much an individual can contribute to any political campaign for city office. We are limiting it to $2,700 in a calendar year. So if you are donating to a mayoral candidate, city council, city controller, tax collector, you will only be able to give a maximum of $2,700, and that is the federal limit. Same thing goes for political action committees, and that will be $5,000, again, staying in line with the federal limit. I think that this is extremely important because we're attempting to take the influence out of the hands of a small group of individuals and putting them back in the hands of the people. It's time to lessen the influence of money in our local politics by putting limits on how much individuals can give. Right now, there are no limits. And we've seen in some cases in the past few years, individuals have contributed tens of thousands of dollars to one candidate. So again, I think that this Code of Ethics is long overdue. I think the one component of this that is going to be extremely important is that the Board of Ethics educate, and there is language in here, that the Board of Ethics has to educate every single city employee. Because as was mentioned in the caucus, there's 29 pages to this Code of Ethics. So you can't just expect every city employee to understand the intricacies, because it does get, it is very lengthy in here with some of the procedures. So the Board of Ethics is tasked, according to this legislation, with educating all city employees and all public officials. So whether that takes place by a seminar or a meeting, once the board is up and running, that'll be up to the Board of Ethics. I would like to schedule a meeting with Mayor Courtright and his administration to discuss this legislation. They were given it, given the legislation beforehand. But I really think that this is something that the mayor and I and the mayor and our council can partner on and can work together on. And we can send a clear message to everyone in our community that we're setting the bar very high where it should be. And that's all I have. Thank you.
Anyone else? Well, on the question, I just want to thank Mr. Gaughan for the hard work that he's put in these so many months, tweaking, getting this. Also, our solicitor, Mr. Minora, I know you worked hard on this as well. It's long overdue, I believe, Mr. Evans. I believe you said that last year, last December, our last meeting, which it is. And I also hope that this becomes a template for other local governing bodies to use in the future.
By the way, I do want to mention, I didn't recreate the wheel here. This is... This legislation, I used the city of Reading as a model. There was an intense amount of corruption that went on in that city a few years ago with different elections. So they had updated their code of ethics to guard against that. So I don't want to make it seem like I sat down and wrote this all out by hand on napkins. I did use the city of Reading as a guide. I talked to their solicitor. Mr. Minora also was in contact with their solicitor. So thank you.
As my 10th grade English teacher said, Bill, when you get a compliment, just smile and say thank you.
That's right, yeah.
Smile and say thank you. All those in favor, introduction, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Ayes have it, so moved.
Sixth order, 6A, no business at this time. Seventh order, 7A, no business at this time.
If there's no further business, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
Adjourn.